Good afternoon, everybody. So welcome to the third day of the webinar series, Guidance Document for Health System Response for Persons with Disabilities and Functional Impairment During Pandemic of the Indian Council of Medical ICMR. So we are starting the third topic, that is the role and precautions of caregivers of persons with disabilities. In the 10-day webinar series based on the ICMR guidelines for persons with disabilities. So disabled people are not only the most deprived human beings in the developing world, they also are the most neglected. These are words of the noted economist Nobel laureate Amartya Sen, which being the persons working in the field of disability, we all know the magnitude of this statement. Coming to the need of caregivers. Caregivers are the helping hands of persons with disabilities, and they attend to almost every day-to-day activities that are critical for the seamless functioning of the persons with disabilities. This persons with disability nomenclature itself is a spectrum. You know, at one side of the spectrum, there are mild disabilities which require minimal assistance by a caregiver. To the other end of the spectrum, wherein a 24/7 care and assistance is required for persons with disabilities. Say, for example, a quadriplegic, a person whose both upper and lower limbs are paralyzed and he is bedridden, for his daily routine activities. Like that's what said, these may range from activities like changing their dress, walking them, and attending to their toilet and bathing needs, to cooking and feeding. Or say maybe an autistic kid, severely autistic. That means the caregiver will have to dedicate his or her time almost 24/7. So the caregiver many a time can maybe the parent himself or herself in case of children with special needs, or it can be neck and kin, first degree relation, siblings, brothers or sisters of a person with disability, or a distant relative, or at times a friend who qualifies for a friend in need, like friend, or even professional caregivers. So the spectrum of caregivers itself is wide. From one end, it can be the parents or the first degree relation to a paid professional, but they all comes under the umbrella of the caregivers. They also attend to the psychological well-being of the persons with disabilities through conversations, giving them exercises and listening to them and connecting them to the outside world, health systems and other social networks. So many a time for a severely disabled person, this caregiver is his mouth, is his eyes. He is the interface between Jalal raised hand. I'll see to it. So the caregiver is in many a time the interface between the world around the person with disability and the person with disability. So the role of a caregiver is not just caregiving. It is far beyond that. It is emotional support. It is the social support. It is them. He is the all in all for a person with severe disability. Caregivers not only have to address the needs of persons with disabilities and protect them, but also have to take precautions for their own safety and mental health. This aspect is also something which is to be highlighted as far as the persons, caregivers of the persons with disabilities are concerned. Because at this juncture, where everyone is in panic, everyone is exposed to the threat of the for the possibility of an exposure to the pandemic, everyone has to be careful, and they have to protect their health, both physical health as well as their mental health, because without a proper mental health, you will not be able to look after yourself or the person with disability. So your responsibility simply increases in this case. Coming to the role of caregivers, caregiver must follow social distancing norms and other safety measures such as hand washing and the use of masks if coming outside the home. This is a very basic principle. Even otherwise, we should follow, because this is the basic sanitization or the basic preventive measure each and every human being in the world as of now has to adhere to. So that has to be very meticulously followed by the caregivers of persons with disabilities. Also, identify relevant organizations in your community that you can assess if you need help. This again is important, because this sort of preparedness, the caregivers of persons, especially with persons with a severe disability, they have to maintain this preparedness. Because many a time what happens is, we just ignore these requirements, and only when a crisis arises, you will be running around for helping hands. At that time, at the given nick of time, you may not be in a position to access to such such help. So it is imperative to identify relevant organizations in your community that you can access. So you will have to have a detail, a list of that. Then you should know the telephone number of relevant healthcare services and helplines. Should you have questions or require urgent medical assistance. Again, as I said, it becomes important when you are exposed to a crisis. At that time, at the nick of the time, you may not be in a position to get it immediately. So be prepared for all these things. So identify a relevant organization, get their contacts, know the telephone number of a relevant healthcare service system, and you should be able to access them at the nick of the time if you or the person with disability is exposed to an emergency need. You should ensure that assistive products, if used, are disinfected frequently. These include wheelchairs, walking canes, walkers, transfer boards, white canes, or any other product that is frequently handled and used in public spaces. Again, this becomes important because we tend to overlook. If no specific attention is being paid to this, over a period of time, we simply tend to overlook these aspects. So disinfection of the assistive devices is very, very important, because there are studies showing that the risk of exposure increases in persons with disabilities because of the use of assistive devices, because the exposure possibility increases. Say, for example, a wheelchair, the area which comes in frequent contact with the person with disability, a locomotor disabled person's hand, and the wheel of the wheelchair is manifold. So if the rim of the wheel is not properly and periodically sanitized, the possibility increases, because it's well proven that in such metallic and plastic surfaces, up to 3 to 4 days, this virus can survive. So that increases the possibility of infection. So each and every minor things becomes important for a person with disability with regard to the protective measures to be taken as a universal protection, which we have to take. These are trivial things. Small things may be in one sense, but unless and until we bestow our specific attention onto that, we may not be focusing on that, and we simply tend to overlook such things. So ensure that the assistive devices being used by them are properly sanitized in a periodic interval. Network with disability organizations, including advocacy bodies and disability service providers, to get public health information and any social support if required. This networking is very important, this including advocacy bodies. And I personally feel people like us currently who are in the field of disability, working in the field of disability in various capacities, maybe as consultants, as therapists, or caregivers, or whatever. People in the field, especially professionals in the field of disability, should be the major advocacy bodies in the given point of time, because we are all facing this crisis, and the persons with disabilities, as we all know, are marginalized group. Their voices are very feeble. So it's a proven fact that whenever a natural calamity or a crisis arises, the persons who are already marginalized will again be pushed to the corners and unattended totally. This happens on and off. So it is the duty of and responsibility of persons, of the professionals working in this field, to be advocates for them. And also to get public health information and any support if required, the caregiver should network with disability organizations. Join a local or online support group or self-help group. Such groups can share the information and connect people with similar experiences. They may help combat isolation and fear you may experience as a caregiver. Again, very important, because only a person who has gone through, who has undergone the experiences, will be able to empathize with you or to understand you clearly. So to form such small self-help groups or to join such a local or online support group is very important for you to vent out your emotions, your stress, and even to connect with others, to clarify your doubts and all related requirements. So it is imperative for you to join some sort of a self-help group in your locality or online, where there is a homogeneous group who can empathize with you because who are all going through a similar phase in their life. So you can connect well with them and you can vent out and you can get very relevant and very suitable, very effective information from these groups. So try to join such groups. Caregivers should provide daily therapy services and medicine as per the guidance of physician, therapist, as the situation demands. Here, again, this is an important aspect because remaining time 8 minutes. Okay, this is an important aspect because many a time we know that as parents, the responsibility of the parents as of now has increased with regard to the education of their children. Because now the parents themselves to a great extent are becoming their teachers because majority of the places online education is going on. So in such situations, the parent need to be more involved in the education of their children. Similarly, this is a time when the caregiver has to be, just hold for a minute because it's showing that remaining meeting time is nearly 5 minutes. I'll make a technical clarification that. Just hold on for a minute. So maybe after 7 minutes, this session may get cut. If so, you all just need to rejoin again. Am I right? So you just need to rejoin. That's all. Maybe after 7 minutes, this session will end. But you can just rejoin with the same password and whatever. That will be okay. So coming back, in the given scenario, the parents are the teachers to an extent to their children because there is no school properly. Similarly, everything is online. Similarly, the caregivers of persons with disabilities should be shouldering greater responsibility now. They should be knowing further details of the person, the disabled person's requirement, the medical condition, the therapeutic requirement, everything. They should be having a further insightful understanding so that they can intervene in the requirements of persons with disabilities. And this sort of medicines and all, as per the requirement, as per the guidance of physician and therapist, to be given in the proper time is important. And the caregiver should equip himself with such informations. Caregivers should seek assistance from a social organization or other health providers to train themselves as a skilled caregiver, building their capacity on specific training in therapy, equipment handling, counseling, and ongoing communication if required to support the persons with disabilities during this pandemic. Caregivers, so this is another point which I said just mentioned previously. Because you need to train yourself as a skilled caregiver. And you need, you have to involve in building the capacity on specific training in therapy, equipment handling, and lay counseling, and ongoing communication requirement to support the persons with disabilities during this pandemic. So the importance here is, again, as I said, just a minute. Okay, the importance here is that you need to understand the scientific aspects of the person with a disability. You need to understand the specific requirement of the person with disability. Say, for example, an autism kid, a kid with autism spectrum disorder is receiving therapy from an occupational therapist, from a special educator, and a physiotherapist. And you as the caregiver, say you are the father or the mother of the kid, you as the caregiver, you are taking your kid on periodic intervals to a therapist. The therapist will be giving OT there, then the special educator will be giving his intervention. So you may be sitting outside and the therapist giving therapy inside, or you may be a passive caregiver just sitting beside your kid while the therapy is being done. But now the situation has changed because majority of the time, since the therapists are not in a position to give the therapy, you should take over to the extent possible the specific therapeutic interventions which is being done to your kid. or the child with special need. For that, you will have to understand why such a specific therapy is being given to my child. Say, for example, a child, an autistic child with associated other conditions. He has poor scholastic functions, and his handwriting and the writing ability is less. And maybe the occupational therapist is giving interventions or therapy to enhance the fine motor skills of the kid. So you should know why the OT is giving this therapy. It is to enhance the fine motor skills of my kid. By doing so, his handwriting will improve. His scholastic performance will improve. So that holistic understanding of what therapy is given for what purpose has to be understood by you, and what therapy is giving done, how I can effectively impart this therapy to my kid if required. Such things, you will have to take an active role. You will have to understand what is to be done. And then on behalf of the therapist, in association with the therapist, by online sessions, availing frequent help from the therapist, you will have to impart these sort of therapeutic intervention to your child in need. Because if there is a long lag period wherein you are not giving any specific effective intervention, definitely the condition of the person with disability is going to decline. So this is the role and the relevance of a caregiver. As of now, you will have to equip yourself. You will have to improve your scientific understanding regarding disabilities. You will have to know more about the condition, the medical condition of your person with a disability whom you are taking care of. So such things become very important. Similarly, handling of the equipments. Many a time, if you have some minor difficulty in handling, I think the specific equipment, you might have taken that to a maintenance center or a workshop, and you might have got it repaired. But as of now, you will not be able to take it for such things in the given scenario. So all such things, you will have to train and equip yourself in intervening to that requirements as and when required. Similarly, counseling. Many a time, the person with disability in the given scenario would be having depressive cognitions, or maybe having symbol stress, or even post-traumatic stress disorder like conditions or anxiety symptoms, whatever. But again, you should be able at least to give a lay counseling to the person with disability whom you are catering to. So for that, again, you will have to equip yourself for these purposes and all the other ongoing communication requirement. So see, the role and responsibility of a caregiver is simply increasing manifold in this given situation. Also, caregivers must constantly monitor the health of the person with disability and keep them informed and connect them to the hospitals if they notice any symptom that requires attention. And risk assessment of persons with disabilities. Caregivers should know the history of the PWDs, like general health details, like hypertension, diabetes, etc. So in the given example, which I just mentioned above, a 65-year-old male, a paraplegic, a post-stroke patient, having hypertension and diabetes. He used to have frequent medical consultations or a monthly medical follow-up, and he's having diabetes as well as hypertension on regular medication. So he'll be previously he was taken to a medical facility every 1 month. His vitals were checked there. His blood sugar would have been monitored there. His hypertension status, his blood pressure would have been monitored there. But for the last 4 to 6 months, because of this pandemic, they're not in a position to do that. So the comorbidities, the medical conditions of such a person with disability is also fluctuating. It may be worsening his condition. So in such situation, you will have to know basically to take a blood pressure. You will have to know how to operate a sphygmomanometer. You will have to know how to use glucose strips. You can simply do a blood glucose assay using a simple glucose strips, which can be done by any lay person. Similarly, a bit of concentration, a bit of effort from your side will equip you in taking blood pressure effectively using a sphygmomanometer. So such things are important. So you will have to know the history of the person's disabilities, like his general condition, health details, especially like hypertension, diabetes, etc., and also the mental health status. That is also important. Many a time, especially during this crisis, the mental health condition may get worsened, and if he or she was on some psychiatric treatment previously, the details of that, whether he or she was on any medication, if so, the medication details, everything. You should try to understand and have a clear idea of the clinical picture of the client whom you are dealing with. Majority of the times, if the caregiver is a primary relative, he or she will be knowing A to Z details of that. But still, they will have to have a clear scientific understanding regarding the condition, so that on behalf of the therapist or the physician, or on the advice of the physician, this caregiver will be able to impart the therapy or treatment things which is being advised by the therapist or the physician effectively. So, the routine drugs which is being taken by persons with disability, the caregiver should have to know. It is better to make daily activity chart and follow up. This is important because first, as I said, a lot of things you will have to equip yourself with. The details of support groups nearby, the details of similar organizations, the details of healthcare facility, everything you have to note it down in your notebook or a diary of yours, and it should be available as a ready reckoner with you. Those information should be there in your fingertips. So that is important. And also to make daily activity chart and follow-up chart is also a very practical thing which can be considered, because the person with disability whom you are dealing, you know his routines, you know his requirements, you know his therapeutic requirements, his medical requirements, everything. So based on that, and also based on your priorities, maybe you cannot be a caregiver 24/7 for a person. You have your own businesses to do, your own things to look after also. So it is all about the efficacy by which you are doing all these things. For that, definitely you will have to be in a better prepared manner. You will have to plan yourself. You will have to schedule yourself. So for that, a daily activity chart and a follow-up chart, everything will help you a lot, both for your performance as well as regarding the quality of intervention which you are giving to the person with the disability. Then role of government in supporting caregivers. These are the few suggestions which is being mentioned in the ICMR guidance document. This is not something which I am telling, but these are just suggestions given by the ICMR. One, people with disabilities and their caregivers to be provided with free PPE. PPE does not always mean that suit wherein you see in the visual media, like with all the paraphernalia. It's not like that. Any personal protection equipment, including masks, gloves, sanitizers, etc., these need to be provided to the persons with disabilities as well as the caregivers. And it should also be delivered to their homes along with ration. That is what is being proposed by the ICMR. Create a helpline or someone's camera, your mic is on. Ashok Kumar, can you kindly mute? Thank you. So create a helpline or designate an officer for separate issuance and renewal of curfew passes, access to food, social security, and other aspects. So ICMR is mentioning that it is better to have a separate designated officer for all these purposes. Issue an advisory to police to treat caregivers the same as other health workers and provide all the needed support as they are providing essential service to people with disabilities. This concept has to be understood by the administrative people around us, that caregivers is to be treated as the same as other health workers. This is important. So the administrative people in your locality, the government bodies, LSGDs, everyone should be aware that the caregivers should be treated as other health workers and provide all the needed support. Because why? They are providing essential service to the people with disabilities, and the people with disabilities should not be marginalized as per their right. They have the right as per the RPWD Act. It is the right of that citizen. So no one has the right to deny it. So the caregivers should be given the equal status of a health worker. Announce the caregiver allowance as mandated in the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016, Section 24(3)(i), the clause I, which is presentation. The clause which says that it's in the chapter 5, social security, health, rehabilitation and recreation. And the clause says that caregiver allowance to PWDs should be given with high support needs. So for PWDs with high support need, you have to give caregiver allowance. That is what the RPWD Act mandates. And many states are already having the sort of allowances. For example, in the state of Kerala, we are having an allowance called as Ashwasa Giranam, wherein the caregiver of a seriously disabled person is giving monthly, is being given monthly pension for that. So so that it is mandated as per the RPWD Act 2016, section 24, clause 3.1. Similarly, create a system to facilitate the transportation of caregivers. State commissioners for persons with disabilities can collaborate with agencies like Ola or Uber, allow Uber to provide free transport to caregivers during the lockdown period. This is a suggestion which is being given by ICMR. This is not just the one thing which can be done, but similar initiatives. Here, the persons, the commissioner for the persons with disabilities can do a lot of things. And this is being proposed by ICMR also. Then instruct the health ministry to ensure that testing centers and quarantine zones sanctioned by the government are accessible to persons with disabilities as per the norms mentioned in RPWD Act 2016. In fact, the RPWD Act 2016 lays down very fundamental things and as regard to the accessibility for persons with disabilities. In the chapter 8, duties and responsibilities of appropriate government, in section 40, it is clearly laid down that central government, in consultation with the chief commissioner for persons with disabilities, shall ensure the accessibility for physical environments, transportation, information and communication, including technology systems. It has been laid down in the RPWD Act. The chapter 8, section 41, exclusively deals with transportation, and 42 deals with the accessibility to audio, print and electronic media, and chapter 8 section 42 clause 1 and 2 deals with the e-media, audio description, sign language interpretation, and section 44 deals with the mandatory observance of accessibility norms, and that too 44 clause 1 deals with the building structures. So it is not that there is no provisions in the act, things are not happening. It is because the we are not simply just not bothered to get these things done. So as I said, again, this is the one area which people like us in the field of disability rehabilitation should voice for the persons with disabilities. That is the role of advocacy here. So first, for that, we need to be equipped with these sort of informations. So ICMR also clearly mentions that such systems need to be created so that persons with disabilities are not marginalized, and the caregivers of persons with disabilities are getting equal consideration and attention with regard to all these provisions. Train health workers and medical professionals in testing and treating persons with disabilities and their caregivers without compromising their dignity and rights as per Section 8 of the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act 2016. That was what I was mentioning previously, the accessibility, transportation, everything has been ensured by the RPWD Act. So the healthcare workers as well as medical professionals need to be trained in those things, especially as of now it is regarding testing and treating for the coronavirus. So the persons with disabilities, when they are undergoing all these processes, whether be it testing process or be it other precautionary measures like quarantine or isolation or such measures, or even a treatment, in none of the situation their dignity and rights as per the Section 8 of the RPWD Act should not get violated. So these people, especially healthcare workers and other frontline workers, like even the police force, need to be enlightened regarding the provisions of the rule and how they should enact these provisions. Similarly, the resident welfare associations and community should be sensitized about the need of persons with disabilities to allow entry of maid, caregiver and other support providers to their residence after following due sanitization procedure. I'll just read out a question. If you are a caregiver and your client is infected with COVID and admitted to a hospital, does your role as caregiver get discontinued? This is a very relevant question. I think after the end of the session, I'll answer all these questions. If you have some queries like this, you can very well use your chat box for that. So the resident welfare associations and community should be sensitized about the need of PWDs to allow the entry of maid and caregiver and other support providers to their residents after following due sanitization procedure. Because at least in Kerala, there were instances where the caregiver or the caregiver from outside were not allowed to enter into residential areas or their specific areas because they were suspecting corona and things like that happened. But it should be made very clear that caregivers should be given access for them to take care of the person with disability in any residential area or anywhere the person with disability is staying. So that insight has to be there in the minds of the administrators as well. Then precautions for the caregivers. As I said, caregiver is not a servant exclusively for the person with disability. He is another individual. He has got his own requirements, his own priorities, but he should also be able to effectively take care of the person with disabilities. So as a caregiver, as an individual, you also has to look after your well-being. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. It's not just for any caregiver, any individual for that matter has to follow these things. Avoid touching your eyes, nose and mouth with unwashed hands. Wash your hands often with soap and water or use an alcohol-based hand sanitizer. At least 60% of alcohol for at least 20 seconds. All these things you all know. Because the basic principle when we use an alcohol-based hand sanitizer or a soap is that in a soap there is a lipophilic portion and the hydrophilic portion, and the lipophilic portion of the soap attaches with the lipid layer of the outer covering of the coronavirus, and just as if you prick a balloon with a pin, the outer layer of the virus simply bursts out when it comes into contact with the lipophilic layer of the soap. So that is the mechanism by which the soap acts, and that similarly is the mechanism of action of an alcohol sanitizer also. That is why we can pretty confidently say that if you use a soap or alcohol sanitizer for that matter in the proper manner, 100% sanitization you can ensure. This is the scientific principle behind that. So it should be ensured that any caregiver or for that matter any person is following or adhering to all the precaution guidelines. Ensure you have sufficient backup caregivers in case you cannot support. Example, you get sick, you need to take care of an unwell family member, you will still need assistance. So make sure you have someone who can provide it. You may need to identify a caregiver from your family, relative or neighborhood. Again, we can just take the scenario of Kerala now, because we are exposed with the coronavirus just like in any other place. But unfortunately, for the past few days, there is floods in Kerala, all across Kerala. Many of the villages, many of the towns are under water now. Many houses are drowned in water. So this is an unexpected thing which is happening in Kerala now. Though it had happened in the last two seasons as well, but still. So the requirement increases manifold. The crisis simply arises. So at this time, you should have had a backup plan to support this. So if you are just entrapped somewhere and you are not able to reach your person with disability for whom you are the caregiver, then definitely you should have a plan B, a backup plan, wherein you can engage some other person for the caregiving. So that some other person should be identified previously. He should be informed sufficiently, and he should also have a basic understanding of how to handle the person with disability. This is not just for professionals, even parents for that matter. Maybe you are unfortunately in a primary contact list of a person with corona, then you will have to go to quarantine. You are the caregiver for your child with special need, then what will the child do? That is a huge question which we need to have in the back of our mind. So plan B, plan C should be ready with every caregiver. So any contingency can arise, because we are all humans. We don't know what is going to happen with us in the next moment. So be prepared with plan A, B, C's. So you will, in such situation also, you will have to take care of the person with disability, because that is your responsibility. So then be prepared with other plans. Identify some other caregiver, just inform them, just intimate them, and if required, bring in that person as a caregiver. If you are not able to get assistance from your family, ensure that you can get assistance from a paid attendant within your community if possible. This may not be a routine affair, but when a crisis arises, you will have to think of such options. And in the 13th hour, this may not be an easy task. So think in advance, act in advance, and prepare backup plans for that matter. Have at least a week of non-perishable food in your home at any given time, if possible 2 weeks, and identify people who can assist with shopping. As I said, in Kerala, for the last 1 week, it is floods. It's not easy for one to go out of his house as required. Already there is quarantine, shutdown, a lot of things are there. A lot of hotspots are being formed day by day. Added to that, now the flood system, flood problem is further complicating the system. So this sort of reserves and all, we should be thinking of, and we should be equipping ourselves with all such reserves, especially of non-perishable food items and medicines. Stock up on other important supplies like medicine, nutrition supplements, baby foods, and cleaning materials, even sanitizers and all for that matter. In such given crisis situation, it is better to stock at least for a short duration of maybe for some few weeks. If you have that stock of such daily required things, that would be very useful. Then identify a way to make sure you can get your medication on time. This may mean having friends or family assist you or using a pharmacy that offers prescription delivery through call or online. In many places, such systems are there. But only thing is that you need to identify such systems. There are pharmacies who are doing such service. So you need to identify them and you need to tie up with them, and they will be of assistance to you. Only thing is that you have to identify and act accordingly. Wash your hands and use hand sanitizer when you arrive at home from outside, and each time before touching or feeding or caring for the person with disability. Again, it's a common sense thing only in this given scenario. Even otherwise, you will have to do all these things even when you're returning from your job or for any purpose. If you have gone outside, when you come back to home, you will have to do all these standard precautionary measures. That holds well with persons with disabilities as well. Regularly clean, sanitize, and disinfect the surfaces that are touched in your home to prevent the spread of infection. Again, this is very important with regard to persons with disabilities as well as to any common person for that matter. Can you just hold for a minute?
Sir, I am in the presentation, sir. I am doing the presentation of the webinar, sir. Shall I call you after 10 minutes? Okay, sir. Sure, sir. Immediately after session, I'll call you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sorry for the interruption. So I'll continue. So regular cleaning, sanitization, and disinfection of the surface that are touched in your home to prevent the spread of infection. Okay. Then use disinfecting wipes on items that are frequently touched, like telephone, doorknobs, refrigerator handle, wheelchair controls, lifting device controls, and remote controls. Make this convenient by having wipes near the items that should be regularly cleaned. This is just a practical tip. But the take-home message is that you will have to be careful in cleaning such items which are being used by persons with disabilities, and that too being frequently used, especially the wheelchair controls, the lifting device control and all. If you are not particular enough, you will just tend to overlook such things. Should be particular in wearing a mask. There should be extra vigilance about not touching their face or yours. So the art of wearing mask, to put it that way, is important. You should wear a mask in the proper manner. A frequent removal of the mask and again putting it may be doing more harm than good. And the disposal of a mask, if it is a disposable mask, should be in the proper manner. If it is a washable and reusable mask, then you should bestow care and attention in handling your mask. Otherwise, that itself can increase the risk. So be very particular in wearing a mask. And there should be extra vigilance about not touching your face or theirs. it is important to use a mask correctly, as I said now. Say, for example, in another certain scenarios, a person with a hearing impairment, he uses lip reading as his means to communicate. If you are a caregiver for such a person, then try to have a transparent mask so that he or she will be able to read your lip even when you are using a mask. These are some practical tips which becomes important in specific situations. But if that is the situation, you will have to look for such options. As I said, in such a scenario, a transparent mask will serve the purpose on either sides. He or she can even understand your emotion and read your lip even when you are using a mask. So in the given scenario, as per the demand of the scenario, you will have to act accordingly. Wheelchair parts such as headrest, armrest, side guards, back of the wheelchair, push handles, footrest, seat and wheel propeller should be disinfected any time a new person comes in contact with the chair or when the wheelchair returns to your home. So any person, a new person coming into contact means even however close a relative of yours may be, we don't know his condition, and we know up to 60% of the case is asymptomatic. So even out of this 60 or 70 plus people who are attending the webinar now, including myself, we don't know who all are having this virus now. So 60% is asymptomatic. So a universal precaution is the only thing which we can take. So any new person touching any of the assistive technology device, immediately you will have to disinfect. Disinfect, because a person with disability will be frequently using this assistive technology device, and there is high chance that he is touching this and further on he is transmitting it to his eyes or nose. So disinfect it in a very frequent interval. The same applies to assistive and adaptive devices commonly used by people with disabilities. Regularly clean, sanitize and disinfect shared spaces, particularly in the living room, kitchen, dining and bathroom, to avoid spreading the infection. Again, a common sense thing which we have to do even with a PWD or without a PWD. If the person with disability becomes sick, seek medical care immediately. If someone in your household becomes sick, suspected of illness, strictly adhere to the government guidelines of isolation, quarantine, hospitalization, etc. according to the situation. So as a caregiver, again, you are bound to know the existing norms and guidelines of the government which is being issued from time to time. So what are the quarantine norms? What are the isolation norms? Whether I am at risk of, at what time I should seek help? So such things. So as a caregiver, it is your responsibility to understand such things which is happening around you and to update and upgrade your information regarding that. And here are a few flow charts for provision of services and care of persons with disability and functional impairment during pandemics, again prepared by ICMR. So it is, one is regarding the care of persons with disabilities and functional impairments during pandemic at home and communities. So two categories they have said. One is not using assistive technology and using assistive technology. For persons using assistive technology, one is routine personal care that is applicable for any person with disability or without disability. And the second aspect is the social distancing, mask and hand hygiene, which again is a standard precautionary measure for any person. And if it is for person using assistive technology, the same holds good. Plus, there is the component of care of the assistive technology as well as sanitization with soap and alcohol-based sanitizers. Then, care of persons with disabilities and functional impairments during pandemic at healthcare settings. Again, it has been divided into two, without COVID infection and with COVID infection. If a person with disability without COVID infection in a healthcare settings, two main aspects has to be taken care of. One is accessibility, courtesy and empathy. As per the RPWD Act, everything is an act and it is the right of the person with disability. So the persons in the healthcare service and the frontline corona warriors should very well be aware of the recommendations of the RPWD Act, and accessibility should be provided, courtesy should be there in their interactions, and definitely empathy should be there. And also for provisions for caretakers. That is important. Again, only if the authorities, the government authorities, are becoming aware of this, provisions for caretakers will be improved. So that is of cardinal importance. And if a person with disability is with COVID, again, the other two aspects comes into picture, like accessibility, courtesy and empathy, and provisions for caregivers. and also special OPD and indoor facilities, depending upon the nature of the disability of the person. Special OPDs even may have to be thought of, and indoor facilities. Again, the accessibility becomes very important there, as I had mentioned in the second class in the series, that a ramp and other basic amenities which ensure the universal access to any person with disabilities is mandatory, even for a makeshift health arrangement. Maybe it is a temporary corona care center. Even then, all the facilities, basic facilities for a person with disability, if it is a locomotor disability, he need a ramp and other facility. If it is a person with a visual impairment, he needs braille or other voice command. So whatever is the disability, the accessibility measure should be ensured even in a temporary setup as per the act. Then care of person with disabilities and functional impairment during pandemics at healthcare setting. Again, without COVID and with COVID. So again, accessibility, courtesy, empathy, provision for caretakers, and the care of assistive technology device in that manner. If it is with COVID, again, all these applies, and added to that, you will have to have special attention for the assistive technology device which they are using. So the session I'm winding up here.